Over time, over history, so many facts have been blurred. But they're there if we look close enough and if we're willing to be open-minded and put all of the coincidences together. For more than half a century, Carlos Muñoz Ferrada astonished people with his astronomical and geophysical predictions. On January 19, 1939, he predicted that on January 24th at 7:10 p.m., an earthquake would devastate Chile. He was only off of his prediction within 4 hours because on January 24th, 1939, at 11:29 p.m., a huge, devastating earthquake hit. It lasted 18 seconds. Do you know how long that is? It devastated 5 provinces in southern Chile, and it left 10,000 people dead. He continued to foretell many historic earthquakes and other geothermal events throughout his lifetime. But what I wanted to focus on was astronomically, he discovered new comets and planets. He discovered their trajectories and orbital motions with this amazing accuracy. And he did all of this before all the information was confirmed by the larger, more modern telescopes that we have today. And at the age of 90, Carlos Muñoz Ferrada finally broke his silence, and he told about his 59 years of research pertaining to Herculopis, or what he referred to as the comet planet.
Absolutely right. As a matter of fact, the date on here I was just noticing is 14 August 1978, which is just about 6 weeks after we discovered the fact that Pluto has a satellite. Once you have a satellite for a planet, you can determine how heavy it is. It turns out Pluto was very much smaller and lighter weight than we had thought, which meant that Pluto has no influence, no appreciable influence on the motions of the planets Uranus and Neptune. At that point, we voiced the hypothesis that this means that there is at least one yet-to-be-discovered planet in the outer reaches of the solar system, and this naturally led directly to you and your interest in what we're doing, and that's when you sent me this book.
You have then postulated the existence or the appearance in some time years ago of a celestial body which you, I think, named in that paper an intruder.
Yes.
Which may have collided with or somehow turned on their side both Uranus and Pluto.
It did a lot more than that, as a matter of fact. In that paper, we hypothesized that this intruder passed very close to Neptune, that it dislodged one of what we then think were many satellites of Neptune. One of them became the planet Pluto. We actually think Pluto is an escape satellite of Neptune. This will also take the orbit of Triton, the big satellite of Neptune, and reverse it. It will take the orbit of the satellite near-read and extend it outwards, we can produce all of the observed aspects of the satellite system of Neptune plus Pluto's orbit just with this one single intruding planet. One of the things we did in 1978, having made this prediction that there was an additional planet, 10th or 12th, depending on your point of view, but it's the next one, we sort of put our money where our mouth was, as it were, and we went out and we started looking for this thing. And we've been searching for 12 years for this thing. We've been able to refine the search area somewhat, get it rather narrowed down. We do our predictions based on the observed anomalies in Uranus and Neptune. We actually are currently looking down in the region of Centaurus, which is just south of the constellation Libra, but very close to the area that you've talked about.
I think, Dr. Harrington, you have a pretty good picture, at least in your own mind, of what we are talking about, a big planet, a small planet.
If it is in the kind of orbit that we describe here, it would have to be a planet that would have a mass something like 3 to 5 times the mass of the Earth. This would put it intermediate between the gaseous planets like Uranus and Neptune and the terrestrial planets that we have in the inner part of the solar system. So if this planet turns out to be in a 3,600-year orbit, then its mass would be correspondingly larger. But we're talking about something that's a perfectly reasonable kind of planet. It looks like a good, nice planet, small enough that it's not going to be completely enveloped in gas, so it's perfectly capable of supporting life forms of one kind or another. Here's the orbit that I have proposed for the 10th planet, and here's where we think it is right about now in its orbit. This is your orbit for the planet, and showing that it would come out of Sagittarius in biblical time, and that once you allow for precession, it would be around into Libra by now.
Some people believe that comet C2001Q4 and comet C2002T7 Linear are the twins that the Hopi prophesized about. These comets were seen simultaneously in the southern hemisphere in May 2004. And the neighbor sky disk, if you haven't read about it, please look it up, research it. It could be a video in itself. But I noticed this correlation with the way that, I guess it's been assumed that the planets that were being discussed in this, where the sun was eclipsed by something very large in 1794 BC, that there seems to be a correlation coming up soon. So I just wanted to add that at the end. And thank you so much for watching. Much love.